Good afternoon to everybody. My name is Al Romero. I'm the Dean of the Weizmann School of Arts and Sciences. And on behalf of the school, I want to welcome all of you for coming to this presentation. We have a very distinguished panel tonight that will be focusing in different areas of this big issue that is the Syrian crisis that we're living in, we have been living for many years. When I look at this, this particular issue, has many faces, but what it reminds me is the famous phrase by von Clausewitz that says that war is politics by other means. And I think the Syrian crisis is one of the best examples of that particular situation. So I don't want to take more time from our distinguished panelists. Again, to give you the welcoming words. And again, congratulations, Professor McManus, for organizing this because I think it's a great idea. Thank you.
Before we get to the good stuff, thank you, Dean Romero. I'm David Jones, I'm the chair of the Political Science Department, and I also wanted to welcome everyone here, and I also wanted to give a little plug for our department. As part of a new initiative to increase global opportunities and perspectives for Baruch students, we're planning at least one globally themed event such as this each semester. And we actually have another event coming up. The next one we have is Global Careers in Political Science, and that's going to be held in conjunction with some professors at Fordham, so it's actually going to be on the Fordham campus, but you all are invited there. That's going to be on February 27th. And if you want more information about this series on global politics that we do, I encourage you to go to our Facebook page, Political Science at Baruch, and you can like us and follow us there, and you'll get all the updates. All of our events. You can also pick up a brochure over on the sign-in table over there, which has other information about our global opportunities in political science, including information about study abroad. And then finally, you could go to our webpage on the Baruch site and click on the Global Perspectives link, and it has all kinds of good information for you as well. All right, so without any further ado, I'd like to introduce Professor Roseanne McManus, who's going to be our moderator for this evening's event.
Okay, well, thank you, Professor Jones and Dean Romero, and thanks also to the Dean for our food here tonight, provided by Globus Funds. So, welcome everyone to our panel on the Syrian Civil War. We're really lucky this afternoon to have four really expert panelists here to talk about different aspects of the Civil War, including the evolution of U.S. foreign policy, the success of the U.S. and Russian interventions in Syria, the implications for international terrorism, and the issue of accepting and integrating Syrian refugees in the United States. So the Syrian conflict has been going on actually since 2011. It started as peaceful protests in response to the Arab Spring movement in the Middle East, but it quickly became violent as the Syrian government cracked down on protesters. I think the Syrian conflict is important first and foremost as a humanitarian disaster. Estimates of death tolls so far in the Syrian civil war range from 312,000 people to 470,000 people. And many of those killed have been civilians. A recent report put the number of injured in the Syrian civil war at 1.9 million, which means that over 11% of Syria's population has been either killed or injured in the conflict. Also, it's estimated that nearly half of the population has been displaced from their homes. The conflict has also had important implications beyond Syria. It's had implications for international terrorism. It's given the organization known as ISIS, or the Islamic State, an opportunity to gain a foothold and plot attacks against the West. It's become sort of a proxy war between the United States and Russia, with Russia supporting the Syrian government, the United States supporting moderate rebels. It's also affected U.S. domestic politics, as we've seen domestic debates about whether to allow Syrian refugees into the United States. So this is a very important conflict for many reasons, and it's currently at a bit of a crossroads due to the new presidential administration. So people are wondering if President Trump is going to pursue a harsher military policy toward the Syrian conflict, whether he's going to cooperate with Russia. And then, of course, there's the issue of his recent attempt to block Syrian refugees from coming into the United States, which currently has been thwarted by our courts. So this is a very relevant time to be hosting this panel. So let me introduce our panelists. Our first speaker is going to be Sara Moller, who is an assistant professor at the School of Diplomacy and International Relations at Seton Hall University. Professor Moller will be discussing how U.S. foreign policy towards Syria has evolved. Professor Moller holds a BA from Queen's University in Kingston, Ontario, an MA from Georgetown University, and a PhD from Columbia University. She's also previously worked at the Council on Foreign Relations and other institutions and think tanks. Professor Moller's research investigates the group dynamics of conflict and cooperation in the international system. Her work has been published in the Los Angeles Times, Boston Globe, National Interest, Middle East Times, and World Politics Review. And she's working on a book manuscript called Fighting Friends, Institutional Cooperation in Multinational War. Our second speaker is going to be Zachary Shirkey, who is an associate professor at Hunter College and at the CUNY Graduate Center. Professor Shirkey will be discussing the success of US and Russian interventions in Syria. Professor Shirkey holds a BA from the University of Michigan and a PhD from Columbia University. He's published three books. His first book is titled, Is This a Private Fight or Can Anybody Join the Spread of Interstate War? His latest book is titled, Uncertainty, Threat, and International Security, Implications for Southeast Asia. And probably most relevant to this panel is his 2012 book, which is titled, Joining the Fray, Military Intervention in Civil Wars. Professor Shirkey has also published in various peer-reviewed journals, including Civil Wars, International Studies Review, the Journal of Peace Research, and Journal of Theoretical Politics. Our third speaker is going to be Professor Alon Ben-Meir, a clinical professor and senior fellow at New York University's Center for Global Affairs, and a senior fellow at the World Policy Institute. Professor Ben-Meir will be discussing the impact of the Syrian conflict on the development of ISIS and international terrorism. Professor Ben-Meir holds a master's degree in philosophy and a doctorate in international relations from Oxford University. He's an expert on Middle East politics and affairs. In the past two decades, he's been directly involved in negotiations between Israel and some of his neighboring countries. He's authored seven books on the Middle East and is currently working on a new book about the psychological dimension of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. His articles have appeared in the Huffington Post, the Jerusalem Post, Middle East Times, Times of Israel, and many other publications. He's also given expert commentary on various television networks, including ABC, NBC, CNN, and Al Jazeera. Our final panelist is going to be Heba Gowayed, a PhD candidate at Princeton University. She'll be discussing U.S. policy on admitting and integrating Syrian refugees. She holds a BA from the American University in Cairo and an MA from Columbia University here in New York. And she'll soon be receiving her PhD in sociology from Princeton University, where she's writing a dissertation called Refugees Welcome. Her dissertation examines how newly resettled Syrian refugees make new lives in the United States and how the experiences of refugees in the U.S. is different from those in Canada and Italy. And her dissertation work has been referenced in The New Yorker and contributed to New York Times coverage on Syrian refugees. She has also received research awards from the National Science Foundation and Horowitz Foundation. So before we get started, just a little bit on the structure of the panel. So each panelist is going to speak for 10 to 12 minutes or so, and then at the end we'll have time for audience questions. So I would ask that you please hold your questions until that time at the end. Okay, so without further ado, I'll turn it over to Professor Moller.
First, I want to thank Professor McManus and the whole team here at Baruch College for inviting me to be here tonight to offer some reflections on Syria. I thought it might be useful to begin with some historical background on U.S.-Syrian relations, because zeroing in on the Obama years in particular. When we're talking about the U.S.-Syria relationship, I think the first thing to note is that Washington and Damascus haven't had a good relationship, well, ever. In the immediate aftermath of World War II, the CIA was very active in Syria, a lot of covert ops, coup attempts, etc. So we've always had a, let's say, complicated relationship. Over the years, it's gone from bad to less bad, back to bad, and you get the idea. The country has been ruled by one family, the Assads, as you know. Since Hafez Assad, the current president's father, first seized power in a military coup in 1970. During the senior Assad's 30-year rule, Washington viewed Damascus with tremendous restraint and mistrust. The regime was considered a meddlesome nuisance, but never a key player in and of itself. To the extent that Washington cared about Damascus, it was because of the spoiler role the Assad regime continued to play in the region, be it in the Lebanese Civil War, the Arab-Israeli peace process, or the Gulf-Iran standoff. When the senior Assad died back in 2002, there was a brief moment of optimism when it seemed to many in Washington and elsewhere that this closed society was now going to have a chance for a different future. The original succession plan called for Basil Assad, the eldest son, to succeed his father, but when Basil died in a car crash in 1994, the task fell to Bashir Assad, the current president. I think this is often forgotten, but at the time, as I said, there was a lot of hopefulness and confidence on the part of the international community directed toward Bashir when he succeeded his father as president in 2000. Here was someone who, at least on paper, looked like he could move his country away from its repressive and violent past. The narrative that was being peddled at this time was that this was a Western-oriented guy, someone who spent many years living and working in London, an optometrist by training, and kind of the shy, nerdy doctor type. It was a remarkably different background from his father, who had worked his way up in the military, and quite violently at that. And so in the first couple of years of Bashar Assad's regime, each little hopeful move that he made, such as releasing dissidents from jail, had with it a welcome tone, because it seemed to long-term observers of Syrian politics to predict a Damascus spring. This was back in, again, I said the 2000 to 2002 period. The moment proved very fleeting. And very quickly, it became clear that Bashar, despite his academic pedigree, was very much his father's son. Certainly by early 2005, it was clear to anyone following Syrian politics that it was not in the midst of some major internal transformation. In very quick succession, we saw the regime crackdown on dissidents. We got the assassination of the Lebanese Prime Minister, Rafik Hariri, in February of 2015, actually yesterday was the 12-year anniversary of that assassination. We saw Damascus become the number one destination for members of Saddam Hussein's old guard, and as such, Damascus became a major player in the insurgency then unfolding in Iraq next door. So once again, Syria assumed this role of being a spoiler in politics. Flash forward to 2009, Obama's first year in office, and the situation has changed in Syria's favor somewhat, simply because there's so much other bad stuff going on, not because of anything the Syrian regime has done. After Prime Minister Hariri's assassination in 2005, the Bush administration withdrew its ambassador to Syria, Margaret Scobie, and the UN Security Council imposed sanctions on Syrian individuals who were complicit in that attack or those obstructing a UN investigation into the assassination. The US also imposed additional sanctions as well. But already by 2007, the international political isolation was beginning to lift, and Syria was being welcomed out of the cold, so to speak. Although the Bush administration did finish out its term still without an ambassador in Damascus, the Syrian portfolio had receded to the background by the time Obama took office in 2009. And I think it's worth pausing here and remembering what the region looked like when Obama became president in January of 2009. On January 21st, the very next day after Obama's inauguration, Israel withdrew from Gaza. This is a pretty big deal, and something that the new administration, the new White House, was monitoring very closely. Now, Obama, of course, campaigned on ending the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, and so it came as no surprise to anyone that this is where his attention was focused, especially in the first 6 months of his administration. Obama's first summer is where things start happening. This is when we get the first stirrings of public unrest in the wider region, but the protests are happening in Iran, not in the Arab world, and things are quickly squashed there. This was the so-called Green Revolution. On the U.S.-Syrian front, things are pretty quiet for the first year in the Obama administration. Nothing much happens until December 2010, when the Obama administration decides to appoint Robert Ford as ambassador to Damascus. This is important because, remember, there hadn't been a U.S. ambassador in Syria for some 6 years, since 2005, since Margaret Scobie was recalled. But, of course, the winter of 2010, and December in particular, is a really inauspicious period and an inauspicious reset to U.S.-Syrian relations since, as you know, December 2010 is when a Tunisian fruit vendor ushers in the start of the Arab Spring with his self-immolation. And the protests quickly spread from Tunisia to Egypt to Libya and beyond in early 2011. In March, the protests start to happen in Syria, and the Syrian security forces fire on protesters, starting what we eventually know today as the Syrian civil war, conflict raging today. But the Obama administration, and for that matter, the wider international community as a whole, has got its hands full in early 2011 with Libya. Obama didn't really want to intervene in Libya, if you remember. The Europeans dragged him into it. I can say that, I'm a European. And he's gone on record since saying he regretted that intervention. I think Libya is also crucial to understanding Obama's thinking on Syria. But for now, the point I want to make is that for most, if not all, of Obama's first term, Syria is very much on the periphery of Washington's radar. They're, of course, monitoring developments there with concern, and late that summer, the summer of 2011, Obama calls for Assad's departure. And that fall, they actually end up recalling their ambassador after their concerns about Ambassador Ford's safety. But there's just so much other stuff going on in Libya, in Iraq, not to mention Afghanistan, that crowds out Syria and pushes it from the agenda. So that brings us to Obama's second term. And it's not until 2012 that Syria becomes more, well, front page news. This is driven, of course, by the regime atrocities in homes and elsewhere. And in March of 2012, the UN Security Council steps up its efforts as well, proposing a peace plan, and together with the Arab League, appointing Kofi Annan, the former UN Security General, as a joint special envoy to deal with the Syrian crisis. Nevertheless, the Obama administration's approach to the Syrian crisis is still very cautious. Obama very much wants to keep the Syrian crisis at arm's length. In December of 2012, we get the first really major policy development on this front when he calls for Assad's removal, since he had called for Assad's removal that last the previous summer, excuse me, and this is when Obama issues his famous red line in December of 2012. This is a red line he issues against the Syrian regime in an effort to deter them from using chemical weapons. Very quickly, just 3 months later, already by April of 2013, the intelligence community, both the Israelis and the U.S. intelligence community, get confirmation that the Syrians have indeed used chemical weapons on their own citizens. But the administration waits until June of 2013 before taking its first significant action. And when it does respond, it's a pretty tepid response. It's an announcement that the White House plans to, quote, increase the scale and scope of assistance to Syrian rebels. But as I wrote at the time, this statement represents a sudden reversal by the administration, which was bound to leave our allies and rivals confused. Now, to understand why that June 2013 announcement happened in the first place, it's important to look at some personnel changes that happened around that time. In February, John Kerry replaces Hillary Clinton as Secretary of State, and John Kerry is very much more interventionist leading than Secretary Clinton. Also around this time, we see the elevation of Susan Rice to the post of National Security Advisor and Samantha Power to the UN ambassadorship. And this is hugely significant, I think. And again, it goes a long way to explain this schizophrenic split in U.S.-Syrian policy we see over the course of summer in 2013. Power quite literally wrote the book on the 1994 Rwandan genocide, in which she was very critical of the Clinton's administration failure to intervene. And one of the most powerful quotes in that book, and there are many, comes from Susan Rice, who at the time was serving on Clinton's NSC staff. And she tells Power, quote, "I swore to myself that if I ever faced such a crisis again, I would come down on the side of dramatic action, going down in flames if that was required," end quote. Pretty powerful stuff, right? So Obama's conflicted because on the one hand, he's dead set against intervention, and on the other hand, he's got his senior and most trusted advisors urging him to do more. Ultimately, we know which side he comes down on in August of 2013. He apparently, at the very last moment, like the planes are on the tarmac last moment, decides against retaliation against the Syrian regime for violating the red line. He calls back the airstrikes. He, in effect, walks back that red line in what was at the time and continues to be a very controversial decision, both within and outside his administration. Public commentators refer to that decision as a major U-turn, but I would suggest it's actually not so much of a U-turn as a return to what Obama's position had been all along. This is a president who had a deep aversion to intervention, especially interventions in the Middle East, and a strong belief that others needed to do more. I'm going to stop here, not just because I'm probably out of time, but also because I think that since 2013, we've pretty much been in a holding pattern waiting for the next administration to take a crack at Syria. After that decision in August of 2013 not to call in airstrikes, everyone sort of recognized that Obama wasn't going to be moved on this, though his closest advisor did try right up until the very end to continue to move him on this. I want to conclude by noting that the history on how this policy unfolded over these years is still very much being written. Important voices like that of Phil Gordon, Susan Rice, and Samantha Power, all of whom were in favor of a U.S. military intervention in Syria, are working on books that will shed a lot of light on this evolution. And of course, President Obama, too, will be weighing in on this as well. But I think we know the basic contours of the story already, and it's a story that has much more continuity, I would argue, than the coverage of that famous 2013 U-turn would suggest. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Professor Moller. And next we're going to have Professor Shirkey to talk about the U.S. and Russian intervention attempts.
Thank you. So generally the story, and obviously the U.S. and Russian interventions aren't the only ones in Syria, right? Obviously you have Hezbollah, Iran, various Arab Gulf states have sent resources. Right, so there's a lot of interest. People have focused a lot on the U.S. and Russian efforts. The general, I think, sort of quick take is the Russian intervention has worked. The U.S. intervention has failed. I think on the U.S. side, that's probably an accurate description. On the Russian side, I want to push back against that a little bit. So the Russians had, if you have a low bar, their sort of minimal goal, keep Assad in power. Clearly that's successful. Right? The Russian intervention happens. When it really acted is a brief period when it looks like maybe actually Assad's going to lose, right? That he may be actually to be pushed from power by the various rebel groups that are confronting him. The Russians, right, have over the years steadily lost their allies in the Middle East. It's sort of down to Syria, and the Russians decide, right, Putin decides, no, I want to keep my one ally, and the Russians intervene. And so on that level, the Russian intervention is successful. If you have a higher standard of success, I would sort of push back, right? If you feel, for instance, sort of has U.S. involvement in Afghanistan been successful, well, the Afghan government's still in charge, right? So if you have the same bar there, you're going to feel pretty good about the, many people maybe would judge the U.S. involvement in Afghanistan with a higher bar, right? And from that standpoint, the Russian intervention looks somewhat more problematic. It's done several things. By keeping Assad in power, it's done what a lot of the academic literature says about military interventions. It's made the war longer. That's a pretty consistent finding. The intervention, unless it's overwhelming and somehow you can absolutely end the war, it usually makes wars longer. And right, the Russian intervention has sort of essentially guaranteed that the war can't end at the moment. Right, the Russians sort of have a veto now that the war will not end unless the Russians are happy with the outcome. But if you look at sort of Assad's ability to govern much of Syria, it's not there, right? He can govern Damascus, he can govern much of the more densely populated areas, but that doesn't give you, as far as square mileage, a huge chunk of the country. And I think a sign of sort of the Syrian military's problems they still have is when the Russians sort of increased the assaults on Aleppo so that they conquer Aleppo, and the Syrians shifted some forces and the Russians shifted most of their forces. The Russians had previously just liberated Palmyra from ISIS. It promptly falls again. The Syrians can't hold it. This suggests that if the Russians pull out, Assad's in real trouble again. And so that he is somewhat dependent on the Russians. So right, if your goal of the Russians is, hey, let's establish a strong Assad that can re-govern his territory, they're a long ways from that. Right? Assad doesn't have that ability. That said, the costs to the Russians are fairly low. They haven't taken many casualties. The bigger costs arguably would have been diplomatic, right? For a while it looked like they were going to have a serious fallout with Turkey. That would be a serious cost. Erdogan changed his mind on that. He said, maybe I don't want to do that. And so the Russian diplomatic costs haven't been that severe. You could think of them being severe, say, had the U.S. presidential election gone differently. But right, Trump isn't likely going to push the Russians terribly hard over Syria. In fact, right, may try to find some sort of way that they can coordinate. So in some ways, right, the Russian costs are fairly low, so maybe the achievement is somewhat minimal, but at the cost, it's probably something Russia's pretty happy to pay, right? So they've preserved their ally. If you don't really care too much that you've extended the civil war that's causing mass casualties, right, that works for you, for the Russians. So, right, sort of come in when the Syrians look at a lot of trouble, prop up Assad, keep him in power. Obviously, at some point, you know, the Russians won't want to be there forever, I would assume. It gets old. But I don't think they have any sort of plan to leave. And so, obviously, right, the Russians' ideal outcome at this point is some sort of ceasefire that guarantees Assad staying in charge. If you can negotiate that ceasefire, people have places they can use it. Right? It's not clear what that would be. Right? That people continue to propose it. It may be that the U.S. stops being an obstacle with the Trump administration, but it's not as though any of the Syrian rebel groups, I think, are in the mood for peace unless they're really, really pushed to the limit, which they're not yet. They're pushed out of Aleppo, but they can still resist in a lot of areas. Right, the Russian intervention, I would argue, isn't quite as successful as maybe
it looks at the top, right? It's met that minimum bar. The U.S. intervention on the other side, right, hasn't done a lot. In part, that's because if you think about some of the things the U.S. wants, it can't possibly get. It would like, right, it's sort of, if the U.S. had a magic wand, you get a secular democratic government in Syria. That rebel group doesn't exist in the back. All right, so the U.S., even with sort of the minimal involvement, right, that the Obama administration got involved, wanted to be careful with who it aided, right? So they're sending some weapons, light arms, other useful material, right? But want to make sure it doesn't get in the hands of groups that may ultimately target the U.S., right? There's Al-Qaeda affiliated groups in Syria, obviously. You have ISIS. And so you're trying to pick a group that, okay, maybe it's not ideal, but at least it's not going to come back, and I'm, you know, things I have delivered will be shot at me later. One of the problems, of course, is if you start picking who you're going to back solely based on sort of their ultimate politics, is it may not be the most effective groups. And so a lot of times the groups that the U.S. Found politically most palatable weren't always the best in the performing in the field. And so that can be problematic, too. I think the ultimate effect of the U.S. intervention in some ways is similar to Russians. You get that same extend the conflict. Right, so delivering weapons to the Syrian rebels allows them to resist Assad more effectively. They're not forced to surrender, and so you have some extending of the conflict there. I would argue, right, somewhat ironically, that one of the actual successes of the Obama administration intervention is one of the publicly more embarrassing things, right? The red line sort of bluff gets called, it looks bad. But if you actually sort of, and then Red Kerry sort of has this offhand comment in London about, well, if you just got rid of the chemical weapons, we'd be happy. And right, the Russian formidable Lavrov jumps on this and says, oh, we can do that. But actually, you end up having a tremendous amount of chemical weapons actually removed from Syria. It's this sort of weird stumbling into a quasi-success in the most embarrassing way possible. But it's like you fall down the stairs and there's like a wallet at the bottom. It doesn't look good, but you're happy to land on a wall. So there's some elements of that there. If you sort of think about the other U.S. goals, right, there's been some targeting of ISIS from there, but most of the U.S. effort against ISIS has been in Iraq. That probably makes sense. There's a more obvious natural ally there in the Iraqi government. You can tell a story how if Iraq can drive ISIS maybe from its soil, someone can actually govern that later. It's not really clear, right, if you drive ISIS from Syria, so maybe you're just helping Assad, and you've already declared, well, I want Assad to go, why are you doing that? Obviously, this may all shift. Right? If you look at Trump's rhetoric during his campaign and what month of being president, one wants to get tougher on ISIS, so maybe then you have more airstrikes. I guess there's rumors of ground troops as of today, which, you know, is possible, though that may be interesting with the current mood in the Congress. Obviously, also with friendlier relations with Russia and the Russians sort of, you know, maybe trying to convince the Russians to buy their line that they're actually fighting ISIS, which they're not. Maybe you get some sort of action there. Maybe you can come up with some, at least the U.S. is not objecting to ceasefires that the Russians suggest, but it's not really clear. Probably the most likely thing is sort of the aid to the groups that has happened in the Obama administration. I would be surprised if that continued. That seems unlikely, but and those groups have sort of publicly said they expect the aid. So you're at a point, right, where it's not clear what U.S. policy will be going forward. It's also not clear what success will be measured. Certainly, the Obama administration measure of success of removing Assad is a complete failure, but it's also pretty cheap failure. The Russian side of keeping Assad in power, that minimal success, but how do you continue to keep Assad in power? It's not clear that the Russians have any sort of end game. But even again on the Russian side, it's a pretty cheap intervention. It's not comparable to, say, Russian Cold War interventions where they really get deep in the muck or something like that. So I guess the end takeaway is the Russian intervention, the U.S. intervention, and all of the interventions have basically just prolonged the war, increased the suffering, and not really moved anything. It's more blocking resolution rather than resolving.
Thank
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Shirkey. And next we'll have Professor Ben-Meir to talk about the implications of the conflict for international terrorism.
Thank you. When I have a mic in my hand, I tempted to sing rather than deliver a lecture. But I want to impart with you a different type, kind of information. You know, as the current negotiation, at least they started the negotiation in Geneva, and the search for a solution to the Syrian crisis, the Syrian civil war. And there's got to be another meeting, another conference sometime next month, in an effort of course to resolve the conflict. Let me, however, suggest to you the following, having been negotiating for some time, there are a number of principles that I want to mention to you, which are connected directly to what I want to talk with you a little later. And that is, if you are looking for a solution to any given conflict, first of all, you have to understand what are the root causes. And you need to have a clear understanding of the root causes. I'm not elaborating, just want to mention to you six of these important, although there are many, many other aspects that you have to understand before you commence any kind of negotiation. The second thing you have to understand is, who are the players? How many players are involved? What is their interest? The third element one has to have a clear understanding is the psychological profile of the people you're talking with. That is absolutely essential in order to understand where they're coming from. The fourth element is, what is their ideological meaning? Where they come from ideologically? We have to understand that, very important. Then we have to know what is their objective, what that objective is. And the circumstances under which the negotiations are taking place, obviously, is very important. And finally, ultimately, what it is that they would like to achieve in order to satisfy the basic needs of all the players involved. Now, if we look at all of these elements, we have tend to ask ourselves, given now the conflict in Syria, and given the multiple players, I can mention to you half a dozen, you have Iran, you have certainly Russia, you have the United States, directly and indirectly, you have the rebels, you have various terrorist groups, you have the Bashar Assad regime, you have the Turks, you have Saudi Arabia, and so on. All of these players have a stake in the war and have a stake specifically in the outcome of the war. But now let me just tell you what happened. A little more than five years ago, I had had very close relationship with the current foreign minister, Walid Moller. And I knew him for years when he was ambassador in D.C., many, many years, and we used to converse and talk about all kinds of issues related to the Middle East. So he called me, and he was in the United Nations, and he said to me, Alon, his ambassador to the U.S. was there, Zachary was still there, Ahmad Mustafa was still there. And they were talking about, he said to me, Alon, we want you to know something. Would you come to Syria? And I said, yeah, I'd be happy to come to Syria. And when I was there, he said to me, we want the West, we want the United States in particular to understand what this, our regime is all about, what do we believe in, and what are the principles from which my president will not deviate. And I was very intrigued by that, and I said, please tell me. So actually, he has produced a little booklet. Let me just tell you the seven principles that Bashar Assad inherited from his father, Hafez al-Assad. Number one, he said, you try to be, and was mentioned here before, benevolent somehow, but never, never allow any kind of resistance to take place. And if it does, you've got to crush it. And the example was, he said, you know what I did in Hama? You have to do that and some if necessary. That is, do not allow any kind of violent or nonviolent resistance to be able to achieve any of their objectives. That's number one. The second thing said to him is, you've got to maintain your ties, close relationship with Iran as well as Syria. And why is that? Because he said in both of these countries have vested interests. They want to maintain their presence in Syria. And they will not relinquish it. And as far as we are concerned, given that we have few friends, We want Iran and we want Syria to be there. Your allies, they will not betray you as long as they know that you are going to secure their interest in the country. That was number two. The third thing he said to him, you must not provoke Israel. That is, you've got to adhere to the 1974 disengagement agreement. And I must tell you, over the many years going back about 15 years, I've been involved directly and indirectly in calls coming from Syria. That is, they have been very consistent, even when Hafez Assad was in power, very consistent in their effort to reach an agreement with Israel. Some people just don't believe it, but I can tell you firsthand, this they have been consistent. And the consistency is basically demonstrated by the way they have maintained the disengagement agreement since 1974. And there was not a single incident happened, hardly one, since that time. For Israel, the presence of Assad and Hafez Assad was good because they knew one thing. They said something they're going to deliver, and they will not challenge Israel militarily. They wanted to get back the Golan Heights, albeit every single inch of it, but they wanted to do so peacefully, through peace negotiation. Then, to maintain presence and dominant position in Lebanon, through Hezbollah. Albeit that has changed, but the fact remains there's very close ties between Hezbollah and Syria, and we know all, I mean, how many thousands of Hezbollah fighters are fighting today in Syria, and that was something that Bashar Assad never forgot. This number five was, you've got to remain true to the Palestinian cause. Well, he has been very consistent in his support of the Palestinian cause. As you well know, Hamas had headquarters in Syria, and but because of the civil war, of course, this Palestinian cause became secondary to his immediate problem at home. The other one is, given that Syria has many different sects, you have the Christians, you have the Kurds, you have, of course, the Alawite, you have the Druze, certainly the largest Shia community, the Sunni, and some Shiite, mind you, of course. Of course, as you well know, the Alawite is a sort of an offshoot of the Shiite Islam. What you need to do, he said to him, you play one against another, but allow specifically the Kurds and the Christians to enjoy their cultural heritage, to do to basically live their life, and this way they will not challenge you, they will support you. We have seen this, you know, when you look at what happened for the number of years, this is precisely what was taking place. And finally, the seventh point that I want to mention to you, and that is, he wanted to make sure that every high profile individual in the government, in the military, in internal security, comes from the ranks of the Ba'ath Party. That was for him very critical. I want you to know, I had this booklet in my hand, sitting there and looking at it, and I said, well, this is something that the United States ought to know, ought to understand. And I had contact with the State Department, and I imparted this information with them at the time. And I said, if you are looking for a solution to the conflict, you've got to understand where Bashar Assad comes from. This is his belief, this is his ideology, and I want you to understand that he is not going, unless he is killed or captured, he is not going, he will remain relentless, and because he's got the backing of Iran as well as Russia, and as long as you have to keep that in mind. And therefore, if you want to negotiate, now think of the principles, the five, six principles that I established before. Understand where he's coming from, understand the revolution, the civil war in the context of the Arab Spring, understand the relationship between the Sunni and the Shiite, which is critically important in the context of what's happening in Syria itself. So unless you have a clear understanding, you are not going to be able to resolve that conflict. It was mentioned, talked to you plenty about the Obama's reluctance, of course, to interfere, and for good reason, at least from his perspective. But the fact that he did not take certain actions, specifically when Bashar Assad crossed the so-called red line, What happened is he was happy to settle for Assad to give up his chemical weapons. But in fact, when Assad gave up his chemical weapons, it was exactly connected to Assad's belief, I do not want to provoke the United States. And what he did basically paralyzed President Obama by giving up his chemical weapon, and that was something that was rather very easily arranged, albeit it took a while to finish the whole process. Now, what I'm suggesting to you today, when we are looking at the conflict and the negotiating process is taking place, we really have to ask ourselves a simple question. What sort of a solution can we in fact fashion? We have to think in terms of all the players of that mission. Every single player here, they have a vested interest in what's going on, and they will not relinquish that interest until they are satisfied that they can preserve it. So you have Iran in particular, you have Russia, and you have, of course, other many, many players, not to speak of anyone. I don't want to touch up on ISIS because it's different dimension to the entire civil war situation. So when people ask me today, you know, what is the prospect of finding a solution to the Syrian civil war, I must tell you, I've had a very hard time to articulate a solution. What that solution is going to look like. Specifically because it is the conflict in Syria is not just limited to Syria, because there is also the larger conflict between the Sunni and the Shiite. And Syria has become the place where that conflict between the two sects is taking place. So it's going to be extremely difficult, if not impossible. We need to sort out the needs, the aspiration, the desire of each player, to see if there is any kind of common denominator that we can put together to fashion a solution. I do not hold my breath at this point because I think it's extraordinarily difficult, but I'm not suggesting to you there is no solution. But to go like we've been doing before, we see revolution in the Arab world and we come there like introducing, you know, you have to live the way we live. Here's a democracy, this is how you're going to have to do it, and everybody's going to be happy ever after. That was a wrong approach, mistaken 100% from day one, and we've been alerting the administration, this is not the way you're going to resolve these internal conflict anywhere in the Arab world. I'm not sure that Obama, obviously as far as I'm concerned, Obama really never understood that, never grasped that this is not a society, and I'm not demeaning the Arab world by any means. But when you are living for decades and decades under dictatorial rule, kings and emirs, where democracy is the last thing that they can think of in terms of what actually can, how can they change the political situation in these countries, you cannot come in and introduce that kind of concept arbitrarily, knowing that what would be the results, and we've seen that in Egypt, we've seen that in elsewhere, and specifically in Iraq as well. So now when we have to think in terms of, when we're looking for a solution, we have to think differently. And how are we going to make sure that the Sunni majority in Syria is going to be satisfied with some kind of a solution? That's going to be extremely tough. How are we going to make sure that the Kurds, who are no longer interested in having any relationship necessary with the central government, what the Christians who've been pushed around and persecuted are going to do? So we have all of these issues we have to look one by one and begin, as I said before, look at what are the possible common denominators and begin that kind of process. Unfortunately, as I said, you know, Obama administration failed miserably in my view in trying to understand the dynamics of the conflict and basically created a vacuum that Russia and Iran were more than happy to come and fill. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Professor Ben-Meir. And last we'll have Ms. Gowayed to talk about Syrian refugees in the U.S.
Thank you. Thank you for organizing, and thank you guys all for being here tonight. So at the beginning of the panel, Roseanne sort of described the Syrian refugee crisis as being a humanitarian conflict. And I'm going to talk about resettlement, so how people are accepted into the U.S. and how they're resettled in the U.S. by focusing on one particular family, sort of putting a human face to the humanitarian conflict. So for this presentation, I'm going to introduce you to Mejid, Roger, and their three children, who are five of the 4.8 million Syrian refugees that have been externally displaced by the Syrian civil war, which began in March 2011. The family is also part of the 1% of Syrian refugees that were resettled to countries where they could restart their lives. This particular family was resettled to the United States. When in April 2011, Mejid accepted a contract to work as a chef in Saudi Arabia, he did not know what was coming next. He did not anticipate, when he left his family behind in Homs, that the skirmishes that began in his neighborhood that spring would soon amount to a war. Mejid did not anticipate that Saudi Arabia, that had allowed him to enter on a work visa, would not allow his family to join him. Along with the wealthy countries of the Gulf, Saudi Arabia would not accept Syrian refugees. Rajet, meanwhile, was alone with the children in Syria, in the old neighborhood that the war was quickly destroying. The older kids remember the chants of soldiers as they marched in their neighborhood. The youngest daughter, who is now 8, still suffers from PTSD. Rajet tried 3 times to escape Syria, but each time the officers of the Assad regime turned her and her children back to Homs, which was under siege. When Mejid did not hear from Rajet, he scoured YouTube videos that showed the bombing of his neighborhood, looking to see if they showed his own house that his children inhabited. Terrified by the fact that Rajet and his children would be unable to leave Syria, Mejid bought a ticket to return so that the family would meet their fate together. It was only due to a corrupt Lebanese officer, who Rajet was able to bribe, that the family was able to leave Syria. 1 year, 3 months, and 2 weeks after he had last seen them, Mejid embraced his wife and his children in the Queen Alia Airport in Amman, Jordan, where they had agreed to meet. In Jordan, at the time, there were already a few hundred thousand Syrian refugees. Now there are over 1 million. While in Jordan, there was no war, for this family, each day was a battle. Twice, Mejid found himself cuffed in the back of Jordanian police vehicles. His crime was working without a permit. As the number of Syrians increased, the Jordanian authorities revoked their right to work. Meanwhile, the children went to school where teachers would not show. They were unable to afford the books that the Jordanian kids got for free. And there were the dreaded camps, Za'atari and Azra. Mejid's relationship with his Jordanian landlord, who acted like a sort of sponsor, was the only buffer between his family and life of indefinite waiting in shacks. So when Mejid finally got the call from the UNHCR that his family was selected for possible resettlement to America, he was ecstatic. When the family had first arrived to Jordan, they had registered with the UNHCR, though they had no say on where they would go, when they would be called, or to which country. The family rode back and forth to Amman for 6 meetings, 2 with the UNHCR, 3 with the IOM, and 1 with Homeland Security, spending half a month of Mejid's earnings on each trip. After the final meeting with Homeland Security, the family would wait 7 months for their security clearances and underwent a battery of medical tests. Behind the scenes, Mejid and Rajet's family were being checked by the National Counterterrorism Center, the FBI, the Department of Homeland Security, the Department of Defense, Department of State, and the intelligence community. These included biometric checks. From start to finish, the family was vetted for 18 months, which is actually short. Usually families are vetted on average between 18 to 24 months, but often it takes much longer than that. To put this time frame in perspective, the 25,000 refugees resettled to Canada under Trudeau, when he resettled that number from December to February, only took about 3 to 6 months of vetting through an expedited process. According to the American State Department, quote, no traveler to the United States is subject to more rigorous security screening than the refugees that the U.S. government considers for admission. Experts have shown that stopping this intra-agency processing, even for the suggested 120 days, as the executive order stipulated, could delay refugee families already at the top of the roster for as long as 2 years. Security clearances and medical clearances have very strict expiration dates, which is part of what would cause that delay. After Mejid and Rajet were cleared for travel, their family became 5 of the 10,000 Syrian refugees admitted to the United States for resettlement in the 2015-2016 fiscal year. Pre-departure, as required, the family attended a cultural orientation workshop run by the IOM, where they learned about American laws and that Connecticut would be their resettlement state. Their son, then 15 years old, made up a song comprised of a single verse. We're going to America where they'll mend our broken hearts. He He sang it over and over to tease his mother, who was tired of moving and worried about what difficulties life in America would present for her family. Indeed, the family finally boarded a plane to America on October 2015, losing, as they crossed the Atlantic, a series of capitals, cultural, linguistic, and social, while gaining upon arrival to America a series of rights afforded to refugees. In terms of capitals, while the family had already experienced poverty in Jordan, Majid's skill set as a Syrian chef had lesser applicability in the American labor market than it did in an Arab country. The family, who spoke no English, also lost language capital. They left behind everyone they knew in war-torn Syria or displaced in the diaspora, and they knew no one in the United States, thus losing social capital. And Majid, Rajet, and their children became minorities for the first time, stigmatized minorities as Arabs and Muslims. Rajet and her daughter wore the hijab, making them conspicuous practitioners of their religion. However, refugees as newcomers who were invited by the American government also received assistance and rights not afforded to categories of immigrants, to other categories of immigrants. First, for each refugee, the federal government makes a one-time payment of $2,075 to the resettlement agency, of which $925 must be spent directly on that refugee as welcome money. The rest goes to support the resettlement agency's work. For this reason, the attempted stoppage of this program for 120 days threatened the ability of these agencies to keep their doors open because they receive a big chunk of federal money. With the federal money, the organization is responsible for implementing the American government's resettlement guidelines, for providing the family with shelter, a home-cooked meal on their first night, registering the family for a social security number, as well as other social services. However, in most cases, as in the case of IRIS, Integrated Refugee and Immigrant Services, which is the resettlement agency in New Haven, Connecticut, the organization also raises private donations to enable them to go beyond the government mandate. For instance, when Majid and Rajet's welcome money was depleted within the first 3 months of their resettlement on security deposit, rent, bus passes, utilities, the organization assisted them by subsidizing their rent for an additional 3 months. The caseworkers at IRIS also helped the family do things like read mail, deal with conflicts with landlords, and manage healthcare and educational issues, particularly because the families lack, as we said, language capital. While in other countries, particularly in Canada, which is one of the comparative pieces for my research, refugees can be resettled through private sponsors, individuals, or congregations. In the US, the work of resettlement is done exclusively by these resettlement organizations that are in part government funded. In America, private groups can only volunteer to assist the agency in this work. So beyond welcome money and the assistance of the resettlement agency, refugee families are also special in the United States as compared to other classes of immigrants because they qualify, if they are low income, which these families are, to receive social assistance afforded to the American poor, food stamps, health insurance, temporary assistance for needy families, or TANF. TANF, as many of you must know, is a work-based assistance that pushes all recipients, refugees or not, to enter the labor market in jobs, however menial. So it's the way that the American government, for those of you who don't know, does welfare. So it's incentivizing you to look for jobs. You have to be searching for a job in order to receive it. This goal of TANF aligns with the goal of the Office of Refugee Resettlement, the ORR, which is the policy arm of the American government for refugees. The ORR aims for refugee self-sufficiency, or quick non-reliance on government assistance. As a result of this imperative, refugees who lack relevant skills to compete in the contemporary American labor market, for all the reasons we discussed, enter at its lowest rungs, with jobs that have bad characteristics, right? Jobs that are poorly paid, that lack schedule control, that lack benefits, and the prospect for upward mobility. Majid works one of these jobs. He prepares dough at a pizza place run by an Egyptian proprietor, which allows him to communicate in Arabic on his job. However, Majid works 6 days a week for 10, sometimes 12 hours at minimum wage. Majid has no control over his hours. He also has a slipped disc in his back, for which he's currently not getting treatment because getting treatment would mean getting physical therapy, which would mean missing hours off work. He also feels generally unable to make ends meet. Majid works off the books for half the time in order to maintain his income under the TANF maximum, but TANF will expire 20 months after resettlement anyway due to lifetime limits, which is how the American welfare policy works. This experience of Majid in America differs from the experience of other Syrian refugees in other countries that operate on different resettlement logics. So, returning again to the case of Canada, refugees there are actually de-incentivized from working for their first year so that they can learn English. There, instead of a logic of self-sufficiency, they use a logic of integration, which is based on English language learning prior to your entry into the labor market. It's difficult to say how refugees in the two countries will do given variance in economic realities between these countries and honestly a lack of comparable data between the two. However, the Canadian counterfactual explains or shows that the self-sufficiency framework, a sort of pull yourself up by the bootstraps approach, while limiting the expense of the program by pushing people into the labor market, also limits these refugees' English language learning. And this can have detrimental impacts. For instance, language is really important for a sense of inclusion. It's also a tool on the labor market. Also, 5 years after arrival, the refugees are going to take a citizenship exam that can only be taken in English. So if you don't have English, you can't become a citizen. However, despite these obstacles and the difficulty of their life in America, by the end of the first year, Majid and Rajet had begun to feel settled. Their children got a scholarship to a prestigious boarding school. They speak English and they're active on Snapchat. They began to buy furniture. The couple began to buy furniture for their home. They've made friends. But of course, with Trump's recent presidential victory, this has shook their sense of security. The refugees are legal residents. The family is afraid, given his vocalized rejection of Syrian refugees, that he will target them specifically with his policies. Moreover, they watch as hate crimes spike around the country, and Rajet, particularly with her hijab, has stopped going to English class for several weeks, afraid that she's going to be targeted while alone. And when the executive order was issued, they worried about how they were going to be reunited with families and what was going to happen to all these people in this diaspora who they had left behind, who they had left in Jordan. Finally, as low-income families, Rajet and Majid are worried about what Trump will do next, right? What about their health insurance? What about this assistance that all these families rely on? So I leave you with Rajet's own words. It was a dream of peace and security that brought me to America. The American government invited us to come here to live a good life as members of a society that aims to have no discrimination or division. And we found that until President Trump issued his decision against refugees. This returned us to a state of fear and anxiety for the future and a lack of peace and security. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Gowayed. Okay, so now we have about 20-25 minutes left to take questions from the audience. So I suppose we'll all just stay seated at this point and pass the microphone along. Yes, sir.
I have a question for all of you. I have to say, two sentences to express how I see the situation in the Middle East. It's the failure of the settlement of the First World War between 18 and 22, as amended with the corrections that took place after the Second World War between 45 and 48. In both cases, the changes that took in the world was as a result of a war. My question is, are we going to solve the Middle East that starts from, as far as I see, from Turkey up to the end of Afghanistan, if you want? Are we going to solve it by a regional war that will involve eventually America and Russia and their proxies? Or we are going to go into a protracted 20 or 30 years process of trying to solve it by band-aid on band-aid on band-aid and suffer all the consequences? You can write the book.
More than a book. I smiled when you referenced 1918 and World War I, and the reason was because Professor Shirkey and myself have done some research on World War I. I think we're both big World War I buffs, if you can say that. On your question of whether we're going to solve the Middle East, the answer is no.
We'll be in that quagmire for the next generation at least.
I have a friend at Penn who does some research that finds that regions do transition from war-torn to peaceful often through large-scale conflict where you sort of get these multiple complex conflicts sort of become two-sided. But often that process is decades long and really, really ugly. It's sort of, and you might not sort of, that's not a good box to check, even if, you know, that does. Also, certainly the World War I settlement, you know, created a lot of problems. I don't think anyone really disagreed with that. It's not clear to me that if you start sort of redrawing things, that you necessarily solve them. You may solve one set of problems and create, right? ISIS would like to redraw, right? They, one of their biggest achievements was taking down the Iraq-Syria border. But it's not, you know, that really, that solves maybe a problem, but in the process maybe it causes others. So I don't know if there's a handy way to undo, right? It's sort of hard to undo, you can't really undo things, and so you're stuck with what you have. And I don't know, I don't have a great answer to it, but I don't think you can sort of say, well, you'd like to go back in time and draw them differently, I suppose, but even that's not clear how you would draw it.
You let the genie out of the bottle, and you have, you can create a Kurd state, a Shiite state, and a Sunni state, and then you, in a way, deal with all the problems.
And so the Druze, right, and the Alevi, right? I mean, you just left out a bunch of groups.
Look,
so.
I think, number one, you cannot impose solution from anywhere. So when you have this type of multiple conflicts, to suggest that Russia or the United States or any other power for that matter to go to the region and say, you have to do A, B, C, and D, that is not going to happen. I think we have to keep that in mind. Number two, if you were to ask how do you end any kind of conflict, there are ways of ending it. A, sometimes the people get to a point of exhaustion. They're no longer able to fight. They don't want to fight, they want to find a solution. If that is not the case, sometimes you need a catastrophic event that's going to change the dynamics of the entire conflict itself, and people are going to have to basically start from scratch. So you have to have that kind of catastrophic event that's going to need to take place. I hope that's not going to happen. So you have, that is another option. The third option is for some of these countries come to their senses, and that's a long and tall order, specifically in the Middle East, and decide, well, this is how we're going to have to do in order to stop killing each other. The problem in the region right now, unfortunately, as I see it, we are long, far away from reaching that kind of conclusion, because the major powers in the region, specifically Saudi Arabia, Iran, Turkey, Israel aside, has a different kind of an agenda. They have a different kind of regional ambition, and they're going to try. Turkey would like to restore elements of the Ottoman Empire. Russia, Iran would like to restore some of the Persian Empire. They have these kind of ambitions. And as long as these major powers in the region have different kind of ambition and are not compatible in any way to one another, do not expect any kind of solution to come anytime soon. To that end, of course, you have to end or add the major conflict. It's very little been talked about. That is the Sunni Shiite conflict. This is not something that's going to be resolved anytime soon. As long as Saudi Arabia and Iran continue to compete for regional hegemony, and that is one of the biggest problems. So you can finish with ISIS, you can solve other problems, but this is an issue that needs to be resolved between Iran and Saudi Arabia, and I don't see a solution to that end anytime soon.
Yes, in the green.
Sorry, if I could just give a non or less flippant answer than no, right? But that was because you, the way you phrased the question, are we going to solve the Middle East? And I inferred from that we, the United States. And what I think we saw with President Obama's worldview, right, this is the legacy of his foreign policy, that he didn't see it as the responsibility of the United States to solve the Middle East. I'm sympathetic to that view. I think each country has the right and should view its own national interests and act that way. So that's some more context to my admittedly flippant answer.
So I have a question for the political scientists and about refugee crisis. So the political scientists, the breaking news at least coming across my Twitter feed in the last hour is that the Pentagon is considering sending ground troops to Syria. So what could possibly go wrong is my question. And then for you, you started to highlight this towards the end of your talk, which I found fascinating, is what would you like to change about the way U.S. and, you know, treats refugees once they're here, as far as like what they can benefit, they can get with them, or based on best practices from other countries, that would be really interesting. You know, how can we affect that change?
Started last time.
So what could go wrong? Yeah, right. So, so the Iraq war would be a good preview. Presumably, if the U.S. sent ground forces, it would be to assist, who would be assisting? Would it be the Kurds or other Syrian groups, or maybe it would be Assad? But anyways, to drive ISIS from Iraq. Presumably, that would be the goal, right? That could be done. But then what? Right, someone then has to govern it. So you go in, you do that, either you have to stay and govern it, and then you get sort of an Iraq scenario, you pull out, you get the second Iraq scenario, right? So, you know, the U.S. staying in Iraq didn't work that well, the U.S. leaving in Iraq didn't work that well. And so probably these sort of things, I would argue in some ways the slow, admittedly grinding, ugly sort of siege of Mosul, that sort of approach to ISIS might be better, because at least it requires local capacity to be built, and so if you can drive ISIS, then maybe you can control it. I don't see interjecting U.S. ground forces improving things. I would tend to think it would make things more complicated and worse.
And then I just want to add one sentence to this. You know, when you interfere, you have to have a clear objective. What is your objective? And when you do so, what is your exit policy? What is your exit strategy? And unless I hear from the Defense Secretary or President Obama, okay, I mean, I hate to call, I'm not used to calling Trump president. I'm not there yet. But the truth is of the matter is you have to have an exit strategy before you get involved in there. President Bush had no such a thing. Obama was very reluctant to even establish it. So you have this kind of problem. So to rush there, yes, ISIS will be and can be defeated. And exactly what my colleague here said, what is going to happen after that? That is the problem.
Did somebody else, did you want to?
Yeah.
Well, it's a different.
The second question.
So keep in mind that the Pentagon is in the business of considering war plans, right? It always has these on the shelf. What's different is that you have someone in the White House now who might authorize them. President Trump has spoken repeatedly about wanting to cooperate with the Russians to defeat ISIS. Presumably, that would involve some U.S. military footprint in Syria. Now, putting aside the strategic question, right, as has been mentioned, the fact that U.S. and Russia have different interests, are supporting different sides there, I also think it's important, and I had a piece in the Washington Post a couple of months back on this, looking at purely the nuts and bolts of the military coordination angle between the Russian military and the Americans, right? Everything from radar to command and control. This raises a host of issues, but I think the general consensus is that it's not a good idea.
So the question was about best practices and what's sort of done in other countries. And I think we can think about it in, on three levels, sort of the who, what, and where of resettlement. So who is, for instance, a lot of countries do private resettlement in addition to the government sponsorship model, which means that, say, you know, a group of you here at Baruch decided that you wanted to take in a Syrian refugee family, you could do that. You would apply with the government, you would get the approval, and you have to raise a certain amount of money, and you would be the one doing the funding. You know, there are positives and negatives with that. One of the things that I see as a real positive is that people get involved. So if you see the Syrian crisis and you're concerned about it, there is something you can do. You can take a family, and so you can increase the numbers. So for instance, the 25,000 that Canada took in, 10,000 was done through private resettlement. Of course, the flip side of it is that there's not as much monitoring. So it would have to be implemented with a real system of monitoring in order for people to then be able to become self-reliant, etc. The what of resettlement is actually the thing that I'm most interested in, which is this idea of, you know, we have a very specific logic of welfare policy here in the United States, and it's not just for Syrian refugees, it's really for everybody. What do you do with somebody who's poor? Who do you blame for their poverty? Do we see it as structural or do we see it as individual? Is it that we should incentivize people to behave differently, or is it that that people, once given the resources to be able to access the labor market in a way that's better, will do better, will have better outcomes? And so forcing people into the labor market, I think, is really short-sighted in the case of refugees, because as I said, these people arrive sort of stripped of capitals and then go sort of fend for yourself. And so it's, there's actually a really interesting thing, which is that men end up not learning English because they enter the labor market immediately, whereas women, because of the cultural division of labor, right, end up staying out of the labor market and actually accrue capital, where the men don't. So that's a really interesting scenario, and I think that investing more on the front end will have better results for resettlement on the long term. The where is actually something that America does well, you guys. So it's sort of making sure that people are resettled near co-ethnics and not sort of dispersed. And that's really important because co-ethnics rebuild that aspect of social capital and enable people to find jobs, etc. So the American government, Canadians, for instance, are very good at that. The Europeans are concerned about ghettoization, so in terms of putting too many people in the same place and what kinds of sort of downward assimilation will occur there. Evidence shows, you know, typically it's a positive resource for resettlement.
Hi, my name is Elsa. I'm a colleague of Roseanne's in the Political Science Department. Thank you, first of all, for a really interesting discussion. I have a quick question for, is it Heba? Yeah? So I'm an immigration scholar. I look at questions of integration. I was wondering if you, what do you think is going to happen with the Office of Refugee Resettlement, ORR, in the new administration? And I'm asking because I know they've been super overstretched in recent years because they're not dealing just with refugees, but also with the unaccompanied minors from Central America. But now the cap on refugees is cut in half, right, from 110,000 to 50,000 for this year. Is that a good thing? What is your thinking? And how would that impact then Syrian refugees that we are resettling?
So I don't know about the impact on the ORR specifically. I think that what's happening is that the Syrian refugee program is a very easy thing to cut. So unlike other groups, like for instance, this immigration ban, right? You know, INA, and I mean, you know this, right, says that you can't really discriminate against people based on where they come from. But with refugees, there's not that issue, right? You can, because you accept people based on that there are wars in their country, and so you accept them based on their geographical location. So therefore, you can say that, for instance, I'm not going to accept refugees from a certain country. That's one level. The real issue is really on the level of the VOLACs, so on the level of the voluntary agencies, and on the level of the agencies like IRIS. If you don't have refugees coming in at the same number, but you still have all these other refugees that you're supporting because you have been a resettlement agency in a place for a long period of time, then you're going to have to cut staff. I mean, people are going to have to lose jobs. You're going to lose money because if each person who arrives, you get that you know, half of whatever money they come in goes to the resettlement agency. So it's roughly about $1,100 per each refugee. That goes to the overhead, goes to paying the rent, it goes to paying the salaries. And that doesn't decrease, you know, the marginal addition of each refugee, right? It doesn't decrease in the same way. It's not like if you're accepting half as many refugees, it means that you need half the office, right? And so it's a real problem. I think that it's, you know, and some of the resettlement agencies have actually written op-ed about this, some representatives, but it's a real issue of like, how are you going to continue to fund this system if a huge amount of the money is slashed? And what are you going to do if he does decide to stop the Syrian program, which is actually the least legally objectionable part of that executive order?
Yes. So I have two questions regarding the Bashar regime itself. Does the Bashar regime, if let's say the conflict ends in its favor, does it have international ambitions in terms of driving Arab nationalism? And two, the second question is there a potential successor for the Saudi regime?
I don't think Bashar and his cronies are thinking that far in advance. They're focused on staying alive and staying in power, right? In the olden days, yes, there was this dream of Arab nationalism, of an experiment with Egypt, but that's way in the past. Remind me again of your second question?
The second question is whether or not there's it's looking very far. But if in the event that either if the conflict ended in his favor or didn't end in his favor, what types of government successors would there be? What would be on the table?
It's hard to know. If you look at the news, they've done a pretty good job of removing, and in a brutally way, right, exterminating, really, executing any potential successors. That's part of their
think that it would be possible that there was a military coup?
First of all, we have to look at the conditions today. In all of these negotiations, of what we know, Assad may stay during a transitional period of time, maybe 2 or 3 or 4 years. But there is no one is thinking in terms of Assad's success or that. He's not going to be succeeded by Assad. He's not going to simply like that. As to what kind of government, this is a really big question today. What sort of government are you going to have? Who is going to be represented in this government? And is going to be proportionately represented? Are you going to have a president or a head of state from a Sunni community? Would that be acceptable to other groups in Syria itself? So this is extremely complicated. Again, that if there's a will that these people get exhausted and they no longer want to end this conflict, it's horrifying. They basically destroyed half of Syria, killed as many people. I understand the number of people who died, more than 500,000, and half the country either refugees or currently displaced. So they may come to the conclusion that enough is enough, and we'll go back to square one and see how can we coexist and live together again. Again, that's going to take some time, but this is my point, that is, have they reached the point of exhaustion? It is entirely possible that it is within, maybe within the next couple of years, if this civil war begins.
Okay, maybe one more question, we have a few more minutes. Yes.
I just have one question, and that was based on your speech. One of the milestones that I got from the whole speech was the fact that the only thing that kind of is common between America and Russia and what they're doing is the fact that they're prolonging the war, and it's just getting worse and worse and taking more time. So, the professor that asked the question about how are we going to end this and whether we just need a war to just throw the whole table and start from the start. I want to ask, do they actually want to end it? Because in my opinion, I feel like they're benefiting more.
Who is they?
I mean, the powers here that we're talking about, America and Russia, as the world powers.
Well, I mean, I think, so Russia would certainly like to end the war if it ends with on their terms, right, with Assad in power, right, or some equivalent government. The U.S. certainly would like the war to end, but again, on at least somewhat acceptable, and it's true of all the combatants, right? One of the tricks, I think, that a lot of these questions are sort of sought for, people want sort of permanent solutions in politics, and there aren't permanent solutions in politics. But sure, people would be happy. I mean, the U.S., I think, cares less about the outcome than the Russians. The U.S. hasn't put a lot of effort in. I don't think we would put a lot of effort in to keep it from ending, even in a way that the U.S. wasn't that thrilled about, unless it was, say, maybe ISIS or something.
So why can't we just keep it?
We could, but I don't know that the U.S. has extended it some. The U.S. hasn't extended it as much as, say, the Russians. Because if you look at what the U.S. has put in, it's minimal. Yeah, it's the special operation forces, some light arms. Does that strengthen the anti-Assad force? Sure. Is it vital for them to continue? I don't know that it is. Certainly it's useful for them. Now, the Russians, I think, they put in a lot more. You might tell a story. People would have thought, maybe Assad would fall without Russian involvement. And then the Russians would like access to the naval base. So, I mean, the Russians would like the war to end, but only on sort of a set of conditions that's conducive to their interests.
Okay, I suppose we are probably about out of time. So thank you very much to our panelists.